beside you, Jesus. Lord, all of this is for you. So Lord, we thank you. We praise you. We love you and we trust you. It's all in Jesus' mighty name that we pray. Amen. Amen. You may be seated. Let's look to the baptism.
El día de hoy, en nombre del Padre, del Hijo. athletes. Pastor Brett, or preacher, or whoever's up there.
Thanks, Pastor Ronnie. Let's make some noise for Pastor Ronnie.
Thank you, my friend. Thanks for all you're doing. I'd give the mic to Pastor Brent, but it would take too long to get it to him, so I got the mic. We are so thankful for what is happening down in Spanish ministry. We're thankful for him. In fact, I'm going to invite the ushers to come down as we continue to do a worship service through our tithes and our offerings. And we'll pray over baptism. We'll pray over our tithes and our offerings. And if you're new here and it's your first time, let those baskets pass by. Your gift is being here. We'd really love to get some in your hands, just a little pamphlet to explain what Arp Road's all about, so get your attention to that. Also, I want to take a moment to pray for our women that are being, they're going to be rolling to Hume Lake this weekend. We've got over 100 ladies heading out of here, going up, and we're just going to be praying over them here. So would you bow your heads with me as we continue to go before the Lord, thanking Him for the baptisms. This offering, Lord Jesus, thank you for such a sweet place that we get to call home as a church. Thank you for the baptisms as people have given their life to you, and then in the waters of baptisms are proclaiming that to everyone. I'm thankful for the ministry that is happening with our Spanish ministry. May you continue to multiply into making disciples and sending them out. Lord, thank you for this time of giving through our tithes and our offerings. As we give back a portion of what you have given to us, we recognize you are in control of our finances. We are thankful to you and for you. May we give in a cheerful heart. We pray and lift up the ladies that are heading out of here this weekend. Lord, may you get a hold of their hearts. Be with the conversations, the travels up to Hume and back. May they build camaraderie, friendship. Most importantly, may they come back just loving you more. May it be evident to all who would see. Lord, thank you for this time. May you continue to get the worship you deserved. Through our gifts, through our worship, through music, as we hear from your words. In your name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
Time of getting alongside that. But one of my favorite things about Res Life that used to happen was this thing called off-campus training. And typically, the RAs would show up about 3 weeks early as they were about to be trained to prepare for leading students on their campus. And they would be surprised with this trip where they didn't really know exactly what was going to be going on. And it was meant to be a camping trip that was to prepare you for the year. And I got to be a part of three of these, and I got to do, I think, four or five over the years. And it's just so sweet to be able to go camping with this crew that you're going to be working with as you're kind of building these bonds. But one of the days that we on off-campus training that was one of my favorites was called Challenge Day. And Challenge Day was literally hiking with your building team and going and doing challenges along the way that you cannot move on the hike until you finish the challenge. And which for me, of course, it's like that's a race. My team's going to win every time, right? We were told over and over and over again, this is not a race. This is meant for something more. But really, I loved doing it because it was actually just a ton of fun. We just got to create these memories together as we're about to be serving and working together and struggling together throughout the year. But it wasn't intended to just be for memory's sake. You see, Challenge Day and the rest of off-campus training was meant to be a microcosm of the stress that was going to be endured by the team throughout the whole year. It's really easy when things are going well to care for one another, be interested in one another, serve with one another, but when things get hard, you begin to see like how people respond in conflict. You get to see how people respond when they're stressed out. How does communication shift when you're on a tarp with seven other people and you have to flip it over and you've been on it for 90 minutes and you can't figure out how to do it without stepping on the ground, which was breaking the rules. And so it was like these challenges were meant to serve a greater purpose than just being fun. See, I love those kind of things, you know, a lesson within a lesson, right? Those Mr. Miyagi moments of like, there's something you're being taught, but really, if you're not paying attention, you're going to miss the deeper meaning behind what's going on. And Jesus is doing something like that here. As we are looking at John 21, he wants the disciples to pick something up here. You see, we are going to next week be looking at verses 15 through 19, which often we're looking at John 21, you get verses 1 through 14 to build up to this passage where Peter's going to be restored into ministry, but we don't want to jump too quickly there. We actually want to see what Jesus is doing here with all the disciples as he's painting this picture of this idea of like, hey, in this last week, since I died and resurrected, nothing has changed about the mission that you've been given, but yet everything has changed about the means. So we're going to be diving into these verses as we unpack that this morning, this lesson within a lesson. And so let's take a look again at verses 1 through 3. It says this: after this, Jesus revealed himself again to the disciples by the Sea of Tiberias, and he revealed himself in this way. Simon Peter, Thomas called the Twin, Nathanael of Cana in Galilee, and the sons of Zebedee, and two others of his disciples were together. Simon Peter said to them, I am going fishing. They said to him, we will go with you. And they went out on the boat, but that day they caught nothing. So once again, it's been about a week. And in the last week, these disciples, they witnessed their rabbi tortured and killed. And then he resurrected on the third day after. And they heard stories of people seeing him. And then they encounter him himself. And now there's been some time where they traveled back to Galilee. And they're waiting around for what's next. They were told that the Holy Spirit was going to come. Jesus also told them in John chapter 20 that he's sending them like the Father sent him. And said also that he was going to be ascending into heaven to be at the right hand of the Father. And they're kind of trying to figure out what to do. And so in the moment, Peter just says, you know what, let's go fishing. And a bunch of the guys say, you know what, we'll go with you. And truly, we don't know exactly why Peter suggests this. It could just be that they're bored and they want to go do something while they wait. It could be to just return to something that they were good at. Maybe they're wondering, okay, are we going to continue fishing and just telling people about Jesus here? Maybe it's to make some money. Who knows? We don't know, but we just know that they're willing to go as they're in this moment of waiting. And they go fishing, and they fish all night, which was normal. And they get to the morning, and they've caught no fish, which for experienced fishermen was abnormal. And it's here that Jesus approaches them, that they encounter him on the lake. Look at verse 4. Just as the day was breaking, disciples did not know that it was Jesus. Jesus said to them, "Children, do you have any fish?" They answered him, "No." He said to them, "Cast the net on the right side of the boat, and you will find some." So they cast it, and now they were not able to haul it in because of the quantity of fish. The disciple whom Jesus loved therefore said to Peter, "It is the Lord." When Simon Peter heard that it was the Lord, he put on his outer garment, for he was stripped for work, and threw himself into the sea. The other disciples came in the boat, dragging the net full of fish, for they were not far from the land, but about 100 yards off. So as the morning's approaching, and these fishermen have not caught any fish, some random stranger off in the distance, about 100 yards off, says, "Hey, you guys don't have any fish, do you?" That's literally what it says. "You guys don't have any fish, do you?" And they respond honestly, "No, we don't. We have no fish." "Hey, why don't you try throwing your net on the other side of the boat?" As a fisherman hearing, suggesting throwing a net on the other side of the boat, "Let me just take this and throw this 5 feet over and now I'm going to catch fish." Okay, they end up doing it. And of course, to their surprise, they begin to catch a bunch of fish. It goes from calm to chaos in a matter of seconds just by throwing a net in the water. And they're so taken back by this. You get this moment where the disciple whom Jesus loved, which is John talking about himself, John says to Peter, "It's the Lord." And it clicks for both of them, so much so that Peter jumps into the water. Now, you might think, like, this is clicking because it's this miraculous moment of fish just popping out of nowhere, which I think it plays a part. But really, there's something greater going on here. This isn't the first time these disciples have experienced a moment like this. This is actually a callback moment that Jesus is painting this picture of. Look at Luke chapter 5. This is something that happened so similarly when the disciples were first called by Jesus. And so I think it's worth looking at in its entirety. Look at Luke 5, 4 and on. It says this, "And when he had finished speaking, he said to Simon, 'Put out into the deep and let down your nets for a catch.' And Simon answered, 'Master, we have toiled all night and took nothing, but at your word, I will let down the net.'" So once again, this is when Jesus is first approaching Peter, like when they are first encountering each other. Verse 6, "And when they had done this, they enclosed a large number of fish, and their nets were breaking. They signaled to their partners in the other boat to come and help. And they said, and they came and filled both the boats so that they began to sink. But when Simon Peter saw it, he fell down at his knees, saying, 'Depart from me, for I am a sinful man, O Lord.' For he and all who was with him was astonished at the catch of fish that they had taken. And so also were James and John, sons of Zebedee, who were partners with Simon. And Jesus said to Simon, 'Do not be afraid. From now on, you will be catching men.' And when they brought their boats to land, they left everything and followed him." So once again, this moment for John and for Peter, and even for James, is this callback moment of first being called by Jesus. It's like it just clicks of, we've experienced this before. 3 years ago, we encountered a moment like this with Jesus when we first started following him. It's as if Jesus is communicating to them, "Hey, you remember that first moment I called you? And I told you you're going to be fishers of men? A lot has happened since then, but nothing has changed. The mission still remains. You still get to be fishers of men." I think it's helpful for us maybe to take that sentiment this morning to be reminded of what Jesus has for us. And the first reminder that I want for us to take away from this passage is this: calling over circumstances. Calling over circumstances. The calling that the Lord has placed on your life is greater than life's circumstances that you encounter, the ups and downs that are to come. The Lord calls, and we continue to follow him no matter what comes our way. I want to ask this question: when was it that you put your faith in Jesus? How long has it been since then? For some of us, it's been a matter of weeks, maybe months. And maybe for you, this is new and exciting and maybe even a little confusing, but you're passionate and excited about what the Lord is up to and that you get to be a part of it. And then there's some of us who maybe it's been years or for decades since that moment. What drew you to Jesus originally when you were first called to him? Do you remember it? Do you remember that feeling? Do you remember realizing that you were at the end of yourself and you knew that you needed a savior? For many of us, we can forget what that was like. You see, my story is I was 16 years old. I started going to a youth group because I got invited and there were cute girls there. And ultimately, the Lord used it to make me realize that I was looking for him in all the wrong places. I was looking for him in girls. I was looking for him in success and academics and just being respected. I was looking for him in all these things, and I was doing really well and trying my best, and yet coming to the end of myself over and over and over again, so much so that eventually, my sophomore year of high school, I surrendered my life to him and started following him. And so much changed for me. Honestly, when I looked at my life, didn't look significantly different on the outside, but I was transformed on the inside. I was passionate. I got involved at my church. I started being a Bible study on my high school campus. I started being a part of a Bible study on my high school campus. I started praying for my friends. Just things that were transformative in my life and exciting, and even to the point where I considered, Lord, are you calling me into vocational ministry? It's so cool to look back on that moment and remember my original calling when God first called me. Do you remember that moment? And yet life continues on, and for so many of us, we get busy. We start families, we get a job or careers. Maybe we've been to church so many times and heard the same passages preached that we know exactly where the pastor's going next. You can probably predict what he's going to say, what they're going to say next. Or maybe you just experience unanswered prayers or unexpected turmoil or suffering. And it's caused the circumstances of your life to really begin to dictate how you respond. Begin to make decisions based off of the tyranny of the now. Begin to make decisions based off what's on the calendar rather than our calling. You see, our lives are not meant to be ruled by circumstances, by what comes our way, but rather by God, by our calling from him. As a church, we constantly say it's our job to know God and to make him known. But that's what we've been called into, to know him and to make him known. But if we're not careful, we can lose sight of it. In 1 Thessalonians 5, Paul gives this illustration, this picture, metaphor he's calling the Thessalonians to realize, hey, remember that Jesus actually is coming back. And he says this in verse 5 and 6. For you are all children of the light, children of the day. We are not of the night or of the darkness. So then, let us not sleep as others do, but let us keep awake and be sober. As followers of Jesus, we're called to be awake in our faith. I've heard it said before that if we're not careful, we can have a faith that is similar to like when you take a nap on the couch and you fall asleep on your arm, and when you wake up, it's like unable to be moved, and you have to like use your other arm, and you're like, I may never get movement in my arm again. But you know that tingly feeling? Our faith can become that if we're not careful. It can become numb. If we are not pursuing after the Lord, answering our calling, if we're not considering him, if our life circumstances are ruling our lives. And so with that, have you fallen asleep? Do you need to be woken up by the Lord? Do you need to be reminded of who he is and what he's doing? You know what? There's no shame in turning back and asking the Lord to help you in that. If anything, what a joy. He delights in that prayer for us to ask for his help to return back to our first love. We can surrender to him and ask him to help reorient our lives again. So once again, calling over circumstances. The passage continues looking at verse 9 where we get our second reminder. When they got out on land, they saw a charcoal fire in place with fish laid out on it and bread. Jesus said to them, bring some of the fish that you have just caught. So Simon Peter went aboard and hauled the net ashore full of large fish, 153 of them. And although there were so many, the net was not torn. Jesus said to them, come and have breakfast. Now none of the disciples dared ask him, who are you? They knew it was the Lord. Jesus came and took the bread and gave it to them, and so with the fish. This was now the third time that Jesus was revealed to the disciples after he was raised from the dead. Bible three times. There's one time in the book of Proverbs that's tossed in there, and then there's two times in the book of John. And the first time in the book of John is in John 18, when Peter is standing nearby watching his rabbi, his Lord, be interrogated, and people accuse him, "Hey, you were with Jesus, weren't you?" And Peter, standing by this charcoal fire, says, "I know nothing of what you're talking about," and denies Jesus after he had just told Jesus, "Jesus, I will never deny you. I will die for you." He's standing by a charcoal fire. And so when he approaches this moment, as he's returning back to the Lord, and he smells and sees and experiences a moment that was just a week earlier, he's got to be flooded with the memory of what had just happened. There's this tension in Peter's heart where it's like this moment of excitement where I'm going to jump out the boat, I'm going to swim to Jesus. But then there's like, you read this passage and people, like the disciples, are scared to ask him who he is. It's dark and they can't really make it out, but they know it's Jesus. Is there any possibility that it's not? There's like tension in this moment as Jesus is making breakfast for them. But it's here where Jesus says, "Hey, you guys go get some of the fish that you just caught and bring it over." And Peter goes to the boat and he counts 153 fish. 153, that's a lot of fish. And a lot of people have tried to interpret what this number means, 153 fish. Maybe you have an idea. Here are some of the ideas that I came across of what this number means. One of them, 153 fish, was meant to represent that there were only 153 types of fish that were known at that time. I haven't seen that proven, but somebody has claimed that that's what they believe it was, and that's meant to represent all people and all fish. Another one was that the sum of the Ten Commandments and the sevenfold gifts of the Spirit equals 153. If you were like, one commandment plus two commandments plus three commandments. Another one I came across was that the numerical values of Simon, so like if each letter had a numerical value in the alphabet, and Ichthus, which is like the little fish you see on the back of a PT Cruiser, if you combined those values together, guess what it adds up to? 153. This one was pretty wild. The Trinity equals 50 times 3 plus 3. And so that's 153. That was another suggestion I had come across. Or maybe even Psalm 51, a famous repentance psalm, repeated times by 3 equals 153. But here's what's most significant for us to understand about the disciples here. As we look at this number, we realize that the disciples were not Baptists, because they would have rounded up to 200. And so, no, but really, guys, the number, it doesn't really have any significance as far as we know. It's not clear in Scripture, and so we can't read into that. But there's 153 fish, which is meant to be a lot of fish, an excessive amount of fish. And you got Peter, who's bringing it back. Also worth noting that the net did not rip. In Luke 5, it had. The net does not rip, and he brings it back. And Jesus cooks breakfast for the disciples. And here's the reminder, which I'm going to explain in a moment, but here's the second reminder I want for us to take away. The second reminder is presence over productivity. Presence over productivity. To be present with the Lord is greater than being productive for him. Track with me here. You see, they approach Jesus, and the first thing out of Jesus' mouth isn't, "Hey, I called you to be fishers of men. What are you doing still fishing fish?" He also doesn't jump into verses 15 through 19. He has to have this intentional conversation with Peter. And yet, he doesn't just immediately go into that. He makes breakfast for the disciples and sits with them. He's not rushed with them. There's an author named Sky Jathani, and he gives these prepositions about how every single person in the world relates to God. Every single person in the world relates to God, and one of these five prepositions, all of us can relate to them at some point in time. But he gives these five prepositions that I think they're helpful for us. The first one being over God. To live over God is the belief that God is insignificant or not real, and so I live over him, I'm above him. And there's some of us who live under God, meaning I live fearful and afraid and anxious and worried to disappoint at all times, but I'm under his thumb and his rule. The third one being from God, that my life is just meant to be, like my life's desire is just meant to be fulfilled by by God. So my life is from him. He's a genie. He gives me everything that I want. If I stay in the right step, I get what I want. God is just a means to an end. The fourth one being life for God, which maybe in the church it's so easy for us to live this way, this performance-based relationship of doing things and looking up at God. Hey, God, are you proud of me? Am I pleasing you enough? And just constantly trying to do things for him. And the last one being really the hope for the Christian life is that we're called to do life with God. With. That because Jesus has defeated the grave and defeated sin on our behalf, and for those of us who put our faith in Jesus, we receive salvation, we receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, that God is always with us, living like that's true, living with him. And this is all throughout Scripture, a few passages that reference this. Colossians 1:29. Catch this back and forth a little bit. It says this: for this I toil, struggling with all his energy, the energy that he powerfully works within me. Paul is talking about that God would work in and through him and that he would work through that power. John 15:5, Jesus giving this illustration saying, I am the vine, you are the branches. Whoever abides in me and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit, for apart from me, you can do nothing. That nothing is not meant to be a quantitative word, but a qualitative word. That you can do nothing of value eternally apart from him. And then Moses in Exodus 33:16 is saying this: for how shall it be known that I have found favor in your sight, God, I and your people? Is it not in your going with us so that we are distinct, I and your people, from every other people on the face of the earth? Being a follower of Jesus is the fact that God is with us that makes us unique, that we are his people, we are invited in. And not only is God with us, but he delights in his children. He delights in us. And so let me say this, your calling means nothing apart from being present with Jesus. Your calling means nothing apart from Jesus. It means nothing apart from him. And the craziest thing is God doesn't even need us to accomplish his purposes, and yet he invites us in. Did anyone catch in verse 9 that Jesus is already cooking fish before the disciples show up? He already had fish. He didn't need their fish. And actually, he was the one who provided their fish in the first place. They wouldn't have had any without him. And yet he invites them in and says, hey, you want to contribute some? You can't. It is the same thing with us. He doesn't need us to perform for him. And yet he invites us into including others in this world to know him. Church, are you trying to follow Jesus without Jesus? Are you trying to do everything for him without knowing him? Receiving love from him? Spending time with him? We get to be confident before him because of the love that he has given us, that he has proven that, man, we can have that confidence because he's given us his righteousness for our sins. Once again, presence over productivity. It's in a message like this that we evaluate where we're at with the Lord, and this isn't meant to be like a shameful kind of moment. So even for those of us who maybe feel like discouraged or ashamed, this is meant to be encouraging that wherever we're at, we actually get to go before the Lord again and say, Lord, you received me with grace. Help me put my eyes back on you. We're reminded of both these truths that the disciples had to be reminded of as well, that nothing has changed calling over circumstance, and everything has changed presence over productivity. So are you numb? Are you living life with one of those prepositions that's not with God? Maybe ask the Lord today to help you with this. And I want to point out one last thing to maybe help you, that maybe gives you permission to do so. Do you notice how Peter responds to Jesus in Luke 5 and in John 21? They're very different. You've got Peter running towards Jesus and falling on his knees and saying, depart from me, get away from me, because I'm too disgusting, I'm too sinful. And you've got, in John 21, that he jumps out of the boat and swims as fast as he can to Jesus to go see him. One is so afraid and one is so excited. And yet, both times, Peter got it right. He went towards Jesus. He brought exactly, in that moment, what he needed to his heart before him. May we do the same, and maybe even this morning, it looks like going to the prayer room. And actually, the Lord's stirring something in your heart, and you need to ask someone else to pray for you. Maybe it means talking about it at the dinner table tonight, or the drive home. this place trying to consider these things alone. We're meant to do this together. But let me pray for us. Father, we're so grateful that you are a God who's given us life and that you are constantly working in ways that we don't even understand. And so, Lord, for all of us, we ask that you help us to put our eyes back on you. It's so easy for us to grow numb, to grow bored, to lose hearts. But God, you call us back to yourself over and over again. So, Lord, may we truly live like our calling is more important and bigger than our circumstances. And may we truly live like your presence is greater than any productivity we can have for you. We love you. Praise you in Jesus' name. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we respond to worship?
Thank you.
witnesses are going to hear that there is nothing above sin indwelling with Jesus. He doesn't just ask for workers and for people to work for him. What he wants and what he's searching for is a lover. He's looking for people who love to dwell in the presence of God. And Jesus calls in us to himself before anything else. We are to dwell with Jesus. If you are new to church or figuring out what Jesus looks like in your own life, we have ushers around the room with Sing Yes to Jesus packets, and it explains what it is to live a life with Jesus. And I want to encourage you that if you have something that tugged on your heart today from what we heard, from the message, from the Word of God, I want to encourage you, we have a prayer room just outside these doors and people who would love to pray with you. And I want to encourage you that going to the Father first is so important. Before we talk to our friends, it's getting together in community and it's going to the Father. Amen, church. So thank you guys so much for coming to church. We will see you guys on Sunday. You guys are just